He joins us on the phone now. Congressman or former congressman, it's good to have you. Thank you for being with us. And I want to say thank you for doing what you did during that period, because there was everything, the media, the culture, everything was against you acting on, you know, you had a hunch and you were right. And I think who knows what would have happened had you not acted first. Thanks for joining us.
Well, Dana, it's great to be on with you again. And I really view, and I think you hit it the nail right on the head, and that is that we are in a very dangerous era that I believe you are right, that actually probably started before me a little bit, probably started in late 2015, early 2016. And it started with people within the DOJ and FBI working with an opposition party, the Clinton campaign, you know, the DNC primarily, and the media, to think that it was okay to go out and set up their opposition, the Republican Party, the presidential candidate, Donald Trump at the time. That's where this all started. And then I kind of come into play. It's funny that you bring up, people like to forget about that December 12th letter. I'm glad you brought that up.
Oh, no, I was fascinated by this because I thought we're watching something historical. And I really felt that it was not getting the attention that it really was due, because I've never seen anything like it. And we were on air talking about this letter and we were like, oh, my gosh, DEVIN NUNES, he just uncovered something. And it was huge. Yeah. I think that's historic.
Well, yes. So let me. Yes. So just kind of fast forward all the way to today. Where are we? We've got all these social media companies fully controlled by the left. We've got now I think probably the worst thing that's happened, but I think it's all related. Mm-hmm. Is what happened with the Supreme Court recently, with the leak of the decision on the Roe v. Wade decision, potentially overturning it, to people protesting in front of the Supreme Court justices' homes. Like, that's where we've come, right? It started with dirty people, the Obama administration, the Clinton campaign, thinking it's okay to use the intelligence apparatuses to attack their political opponents. That's stuff that happens in third world countries, by the way, in dictatorships. And it ends with justices being harassed at their home. Like, they've destroyed every single institution.
Yes.
So, it's the reason why I left Congress, because of what our inability for this country to communicate, basic communications, because they've shut down and they control the internet.
Yeah.
But let me just quickly go back to that December 12th date, and you'll probably be interested in it. So this is December of 2016. You have to remember that I had been I was chairman of the House Intelligence Committee at the time. I had spent a lot of time in Eastern Europe, a lot of time on the Russian issue, the Putin issue. And I had actually early in 2016, I finally, which was very unusual for me, I kind of raised a red flag and said, you know, for lack of a better term here, what the hell are you guys doing with Putin? Like, the guy, like, we're spending billions of dollars and Putin's just, he's having his way with us in Syria and in North Africa. We've got the Benghazi screw up. He goes into Crimea, like, kind of stating the obvious that one should ask, like, you guys are a joke. Like, are you guys afraid of Putin? I mean, that's basically what I said at the time. Now, during all that time, that's in the spring of 16. And in fact, you'll love this. I actually said that publicly on CNN of all
yes,
places.
Yes, I remember that. I remember that.
So then we get to the end of the, you know, we get to election. Donald Trump wins. We get our normal briefing on election interference that, you know, people used to not know that we, you know, what types of briefings that we had, because, you know, we are the intelligence committee.
Yeah.
We are handling classified information. It's probably a good idea that we don't tell people what we're talking about, right?
Yeah, a little bit.
So that briefing occurs, 10 days, 2 weeks after the election, Donald Trump wins. And there's nothing. It's all normal. You know, everybody's in there. Everybody tells us, hey, here's what happened. Yeah, Putin's a thug. We know what he did. He's always playing games. But it was almost nothing that he did, right? It was just the norm that he always does. And by the way, Dana, that was the real intelligence.
Yeah.
That's what really happened, right? So you can imagine, home for Thanksgiving, right after Thanksgiving, it comes out that they go to the Senate and they say, Russia, Trump. And I'm sitting there going, what in the hell is this? Like, if you either won, you guys just lied to me and lied to Congress, right? Because you just gave us all this information, or, you know, and or, you know, clearly this is some type of leak. And that's what led to that December 12th, you know, letter that I sent. And of course, all hell breaks loose a month later when they finally give us the Steele dossier, yes, acting like that's some intelligence product. It is quite a story, but thank you for, you know, kind of bringing that up. And I think all of this is related, what we're dealing with
exactly
right now.
Exactly, like, because it's like this, and we're talking with Devin, yeah, Nunes, because this disinformation board, and that's why I played that audio of Nina Jankowicz. I mean, all of this, for people who may not know all of Nunes's history, I mean, he was the one, he fought the stonewalling by the FBI, by the DOJ. He was the one who found out that the Obama administration was unmasking all of these people, going after people like Michael Flynn, going after people like Carter Page. You had to go to court with the dossier folks. And then that's when it was all discovered that it was Hillary Clinton and the DNC, because these trials are all going on right now. Michael Sussman, the Clinton lawyer, they discovered that Clinton lied. She got fined, discovered that she lied about paying for the dossier. Sussman and Perkins Coie and all these people, now because of this Durham investigation, all spawning from your discovery, we're starting to finally get a little bit of the justice that I think that people have been waiting for 5 years, 6 years now to see.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I think what you're seeing right now, Durham essentially is going to court with, you know, both hands tied behind his back and probably blindfolded, because he's in D.C. 95% of the people did not vote for Donald Trump. He clearly already has jurors that are a problem. But, you know, I give him credit, right? He's bringing something very narrow with Sussman about lying to the FBI. But in the process of all of this, he's essentially able to bring to the forefront all the, you know, kind of the conspiracy. Well, not kind of, the conspiracy that occurred here, because everybody knew about this, right? So, and your listeners know this also, but let's not play games here. Obama knew, Clinton knew, Biden knew. The DOJ, dirty cops at DOJ and FBI knew. And I think probably worst of all this is that the media knew, Dana.
Yeah.
The media was totally complicit in this. And, you know, and I think it's a really telling sign. And that's why, kind of going back to what we talked about, this really is the disinformation era. And at the forefront of this are the 95% of the fake news companies that continue to put this fake news out. There ought to be at least 20, 30, 40 prominent journalists and probably another 100 editors and others who should be fired, who should have fired years ago.
Well, they were the ones who were on the payroll for Fusion GPS. At least a couple of them, we found out their names, but I know a lot of that information was redacted. They were the ones who were writing stories based on all those leaks.
Well, and now we know, because of Durham and because of the emails that have surfaced, so a lot of this work, you know, was done. Lee Smith, who wrote the book, The Plot Against the President, mm-hmm, who was probably the definitive work piece on that kind of that era when we uncovered all of this, you know, he was able to build just by looking at social media, the Clinton and DNC's press releases, and what the media was writing. You know, he basically uncovered this with circumstantial evidence. Well, now the direct evidence, the emails have now surfaced. And some of those were talked about yesterday, mm-hmm, where it was clear these guys were all in on it. And so, I hope that Durham is going to be, I hope that the jury and our fellow Americans do the right thing in Washington, D.C. I don't know if that's going to happen. Durham, you know, he's in a tough spot, but I give him credit. And I think that's, I think if, and I said this last night, on Sean Hannity's show, if Durham didn't have to bring this in D.C., if this would have been, this case against Sussman, the Clinton lawyer, was brought in any other state, Sussman would have already pled guilty and copped a plea.
Wow.
I guarantee you. Because I think that was Durham's main goal here, was to, you know, he knows the conspiracy took place. He knows these guys were all in on it. We all know. But Sussman is essentially rolling the dice that he's going to get a contaminated jury. Because, look, if he pleads guilty, he would have to essentially say, yeah, all these guys were in on it. Right? I mean, they're trying to basically say, like, oh, he just did this all on his own. which we know is a bunch of
nonsense. That's not true.
I was going to say something else, but I know you're a family-friendly show.
Yeah, we might get in trouble. We got a few hundred affiliates across the country. We might get in a little trouble. Talking to Devin Nunes, who's also the CEO of Trump Media and Technology Group. Of course, they do True Social. And I wanted to ask you as well, you know, in with all of this that we're seeing with the legal proceedings in this Durham case and this disinformation board, I've never seen anything like this. How we're really in a fight right now for free speech. It feels like America is in this, you know, it's a new revolution, right? It's like this revolution, this sort of civil war of ideas and ideologies. But I really feel like we're on the cusp of losing a lot as it pertains to expression, just being able to ask questions. I saw what you went through. I saw the legal absolute hell that they put you through, and it shocked me. I really think took assessment, and your case and everything that you did made me distrust my government so much I can't even put it into words. But I wanted to get your thoughts. You were right in the middle of the storm. How bad is it, and are we ever going to get back to a sense of normalcy and at least a little bit of faith in the institutions that we as taxpayers support?
Well, one, I think this is largely, Durham is kind of a man standing by himself. Only, you know, he's the guy that is the only guy with power right now, because he's got the special counsel statute, and, you know, it's ultimately going to come down to these jurors. Now,
didn't one of the jurors get into, like, one of these jurors for these cases were like their child was on the same rowing team as, like, there was like a lot of conflict of interest with some of these jurors, correct?
Yeah, well, that's like just one of, that just broke in the last like couple hours. But forget that. Let's talk about, we can go on and on here. You've got the judge whose wife was a lawyer for Lisa Page, one of the lovebirds, one of the dirty cops at DOJ and FBI.
Oh, so nice.
I mean, you've got multiple jurors that Durham clearly didn't want because they were supporters of AOC and the Clinton campaign. So there's a lot of shenanigans going on here. This judge should not have taken this case. I mean, my guess is that Durham had to bring it in D.C. because of where people lived. I'm assuming he had to do that. But, you know, the disinformation board, I think, are things going to get better? You know, right now, you know, I don't think so. I don't think we should be doing a victory lap right now.
Oh, definitely not.
Because of this disinformation board. Look, it only got put on pause. If I know these guys like I think I know them, I've dealt with them for two decades. All they did was they made a major mistake they got a hardcore leftist to do the job. They didn't do their homework because she was a disinformation specialist herself, right? She specialized. I mean, you want to talk about Russian disinfo? She was, not only did she go along with the Russia hoax, she also went along with the cover up of the Hunter Biden laptop from hell story.
Yep.
So I think they were taking on so much damage and so much water. The left in this country, my experience with them, they've gotten more and more radicalized. Until they get extreme, extreme pain, do they make a change? And my guess is somebody in some of the fake news bureaus probably came to say, look, the disinformation specialist czar, it's going to get a lot worse for her, because I'm sure there was a lot more dirt out there her that was going to continue to come forward.
Oh, completely.
So she was going to be the gift that keeps on giving for Republicans. But look, now you see, they already went back and said, oh, we're just going to reprogram this. We're going to redo it. We're going to look at it. So this is not gone for good. It's just a temporary pause because they were bleeding too much politically.
Yeah, we got to keep pushing against it. I'd love to have you back to talk more. Devin Nunes, now the CEO of Trump Media and Technology Group behind Truth Social as well. And I hope they need to make a movie of your life. And if they don't, I'll write the screenplay for it myself, because this is too wild. I mean, this is like, I mean, it really is some kind of like Jack Reacher vein stuff. It really is. Devin Nunes, always a pleasure. Thank you, sir.
Hey, Dan, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Take care.